and you're going to see how the market is absorbing those. You're going to know relatively in advance when that change is going to come about, because the supply will start shrinking, and then all of a sudden, what's going to happen? Price is going to start to come back up in what you're doing. So look at some of that stuff out there and go forward. How you can use historical data. Well, some of our people that are older like myself, when was the period of the Great Depression?
1929.
1929? Okay.
That's when it started. It got really bad about 33.
What was the worst year of the Depression?
Early 30s, wasn't it?
33.
Yeah.
1933 was the worst year in Depression. The market, the right now as it stands, that was the worst year in the stock market. It went down 53.99%.
Unemployment was 24%.
Following that year in 1934, the market was only down 1.44%. But if you consider the fact that the market was down in 1934 over 65% by the time the year ended, being down 1.44% was nothing. What was the biggest gain out there? Pardon me. I stand corrected. I'm reading backwards on my numbers. 1933 was the best year in the market. 1933, the market came back 53.99%. The worst year in the market was 1931, down 43%. So when you start seeing some of these recoveries take place, just as what Ron was talking to you about, they're going to be steep and quick. How much is the market up this year?
46%.
Yeah.
Over 50%.
Yeah.
Do you hear that in the news?
No, they don't hear it. But if you do your math, if it's down 1,000, it goes down 2%, it's down 500. If it goes up 50% from 500 instead of 50, it's still down 25%.
It's still down 25%, but where did you buy into the market?
Assuming you were smart enough to know with the downturn, if you have the capital and you could get the mortgage, then you could buy low.
You buy that.
But if my dad used to say that there were stocks in the Depression, he was there where you could buy the stock for its annual dividend. You know, blue chip stocks for the annual dividend. The trouble was nobody had the money to buy it.
That's one of the things that I don't subscribe to out there, because I think there's a lot of people that still have equity in their property. I'm one of them. I have over six figures. Yeah, I have over six figures in equity on my property. But I think there's a lot of people out there that I had one client who has well over $100,000 in equity, but unfortunately his job just kind of cut his contract, so we couldn't do the refinance on them. I think there's more people out there like that than are at the opposite end that are upside down. And, you know, that's a small percentage. But again, reverse the numbers. What's the unemployment number? The unemployment number is 12%. Well, if we use the higher number, 16%, figuring out all the ones that fall off, what's that mean? It still means 84 out of 100 people are working, right? Why don't we look at those numbers in that way? How many homes are in foreclosure on a percentage basis for the properties that are owned? Look at it on the other side of the coin. You know, if it's 10% or 12%, whatever the number is, that means we got 88 or 90 homes that people aren't up, you know, that aren't being foreclosed on. Instead of looking at the negative side of the numbers, look at the positive side of the numbers, and that helps your mind think, and that's going to help you look at things in a different perspective. And realize that, hey, you know, things aren't that bad. But I still do believe that in my layman's point of view, that the markets, our real estate market, still going to continue to drop. And you know, Rod's point, the other one that you didn't get was the moratorium.
Foreclosure moratorium?
Yeah, the foreclosure moratorium.
Yeah, I called it the Obamatorium.
Oh, okay, you called it the, you know. They don't talk about that again. That's another one they don't talk about. Oh, yeah, well, the numbers, da-da-da-da. And, you know, here's the moratorium that they held off on, created this false sense in the market that, you know, it's what's going on. But again, you know, what Ron's talking about, the tax situation, yeah, the tax situation is creating a lot of stuff that's going on out there. You know, what about, and correct me if I'm wrong on this one, the IRS forgiveness goes away at the end of this year, too. Is that correct?
No, never on first mortgages, it's been the schedule for years.
on your primary residence, first mortgage only. Mm-hmm. There is, when they forgive the, when you go into foreclosure, theoretically, when debt is forgiven, it's a taxable event.
Because it's a capital gain.
It's earned income, basically, and mm-hmm. they say there's no taxes on it. The problem is, if you have a second on it, and they foreclose,
okay.
the amount they've given the second is taxable. If you have an investment property and it's foreclosed on, the amount of difference is taxable income. And the IRS wants their money on April 15th of the following year.
Is there one that they did have a moratorium on through the end of this year?
No.
Not? Okay.
Right. Basically, I think the right. tax deal, you're right, the end of November.
Yeah, I'm 30.
One of the things that I'm just going to close on the investment arena, and the counselor is right in regards to REITs. REITs another area that if you don't look at, because you can really segregate what you're looking at for REITs, real estate investment trust. You can get involved in any specialization in REIT. If you want to get involved in companies that are in energy, natural gas, timber, you want specifically multi-unit complexes, you want them only in the southwest part of the country, you can slice down to what you want. And the beauty of a REIT is you can sell it tomorrow. You know, you don't have that long, drawn-out process. You can buy it today, sell it tomorrow. You can be in and out of it. It's another way to invest in real estate. But there's a fund out there that's managed by a company called Van Canten. It's called their Global Franchise Fund. This fund originated to the public back in 1998. It's had one down year. That was last year. It's averaged over 10%. It's kind of a unique fund, and the reason being is that it's limited in what it invests in. Most mutual funds have hundreds of companies in them. This one has less than 40 companies. They're all brand name companies. British American Tobacco, Philip Morris, Cadbury, Nestle. But there's things out there like this that continue to perform even in the conditions that we have out there. And when you've had a fund that, if you invested $10,000 in it in 1998, as of the end of June, you'd have over $27,000 in it. I mean, just look beyond the numbers. You know, part of what I'm saying is look beyond the numbers, look into it, or dig a little bit. Keep on asking the questions. And, you know, communicate with the people that are out there that have those answers that can help you with it. Because they're going to help you, make better decisions on what you're doing. And that's, you know, the bottom line. That plan, when you go back to that plan, that's going to hold your feet to the fire. It's not going to be an emotional thing. You know, because what I tell people with the market is, look, folks, market's emotion driven. Not driven a lot on the technical side. It goes up and it goes down. But just watch the news. If you don't believe me, watch the news as it comes out and see the effect that the market has on the market. Housing was up. Housing was down. Unemployment was up. And did they build that in or not? But the market is hugely emotion driven. But if you do it in the long term, just like what was mentioned before, the long term smooths out all this. And when you plot that line, then you take it. And the best piece, or the best reference to that I can give you is there's a gentleman by the name of Peter Lynch. He ran into Joe and Fly, if you remember the Joe and Fly store out, but all the fun. But he ran it in the 80s when it was a screamer. It was going off the charts, and he retired at it. And they asked him why. He said, well, look, I looked at my family health history. My grandfather passed away when he was in his middle 40s. My father had a heart attack when he was in his middle 40s. I'm turning 45 this year. So he decides to retire. Okay. They asked him years later, said, how often do you look at your investments? And he goes, if I look at them more than 2 times a year, it's too much. Because he has a plan. He makes his adjustments a couple times a year. Looking at Kramer every night on the television. It's entertainment. That's why Kramer's on TV. He's up there to entertain you. And what I tell people about television, how much has the television ever paid you to watch? Thank you.
Thanks, Kurt.